This is our Saab 900 Turbo. The challenge was to buy and restore a car like this for a grand. I found this solid runner for £600, which leaves Ed just £400 to spend on doing it up. Will he be able to turn our sorry Saab 900 into a sexy Swede once again, so I can sell it on for a profit?
So here we are back at the workshop. This is where it's all going to happen. This is where the restoration begins. The Saab is here. The drive down was a little scary. The brakes, a bit dodgy. And this is a powerful car. It needs to stop as well as it goes. So the first job, take the wheels off, have a look at the brakes and see what he's doing. Now we're lucky enough to have a nice big two-post lift. If all you've got is a trolley jack, just remember the ground has to be level and flat. And the car, when it's lifted up, needs to be put on axle stands to make sure it's secure. Okay, these wheel nuts are now finger tight, so I'm just going to take off the last one here and remove the wheel, which hopefully should reveal a disc brake, and it does. And straight away we can see here there's some pretty bad grooving and scoring actually in the disc, and it's very, very thin as well, which is obviously very badly worn. And we look to the caliper, we can also see the pads pretty worn too, so we're going to need to replace all of this to make sure that it's safe to drive. This is the front brake caliper, which houses the brake pads, which then work on the disc to actually slow the car. On our Saab, it has a handbrake mechanism on this front caliper. I've released that so I can now get at the pads. I need to remove a few little bits and pieces to get at them. There goes an R-clip. Just pull that out there, and we're going to lose a spring at the same time. And inside here, we should get the pads out. They can be a little sticky. Okay. Now this pad isn't that bad, but you can see it's got quite a lot of wear. If we compare this to a normal one, quite a difference in thickness. And also it's wearing quite unevenly. So it's a good thing that we're changing these over. And now try and get the other one out. There we go. Again, even more wear. And this one is almost down to the metal, which is very dangerous.
Loosen the retaining bolts and the caliper can easily be removed from the disc.
Okay, so we remove this. This is a bungee cable. Top tip at the moment is we're going to have to support the caliper to stop the strain on the brake pipes. Getting the disc off is really easy. We just undo the two retaining screws like this. We give it a bit of a tap with a hammer. And off it pops. Look at that, that is nasty. Now we come to the tricky bit. We have to put the pads back into the caliper. Of course, now they're much, much thicker. So we have to wind back the piston inside the caliper. You can use a special tool or just a pair of pliers if you can get away with it. There we go, and we're lucky. We can get away with this. It's going in quite nicely, albeit slowly. Okay, we've managed to wind that clockwise all the way back in. I was really worried about that job, but it's perfect. Just cleaning off the sticky substance that comes when you buy a brand new disc. It's protective coating to keep the surface unrusty, but obviously it doesn't really help your stopping because it's very greasy. But while we're here, we can have a look at the original disc, which is really, really rather nasty. You see it's all warped and got lines on all over it. It's just disgusting, really. This is a nice, new, fat, shiny one. Last piece of the puzzle, the pads. Nice, fresh, thick, new ones. Hopefully they'll just slot straight into position. Okay, that's the second pad in. All we've got to do now is just make sure that the wheel is still free to move. Otherwise, I'm not going to be going anywhere quickly, which it is. So now I just have to put the pins back in, put the wheel on, and get on with the other brakes.
If you're changing the discs and pads on the near side of the car, then you must also change them on the off side. This makes sure that when you brake, the car doesn't pull to one side. To be 100% safe, I'm also replacing the rear brakes. The parts aren't that expensive for a job like this, only about £70, but by doing it myself, I'm making a huge saving. If I took this job to the High Street garage, it could cost as much as £400.
And An important point, once the car is back on the ground, you must remember to tighten your wheel nuts and put the cap on. And that's the brakes done, so on with the next job. The Saab 900 Turbo is a quality car and they're normally really reliable, but they do have an Achilles heel. When they get to this kind of age, the electric windows tend to fail. Now Mike, of course, has got us a classic example of this, and these electric windows just don't work. Now because it's an electrical problem, it can be quite hard to fix, and it might even be the reason this car was up for sale. The first thing we're going to have to do is to find out where exactly the problem is. There are two simple things we can try. First of all, the switches themselves. I'll just turn the ignition on. So now I can hear a clunking, which means that the fault isn't with the switches. So it could be with a blown fuse. The window regulator is fuse number 11. So let's have a look in here. Okay, well you can see from this that the fuse is perfectly intact. Unfortunately, this means it isn't a quick fix and it could get expensive. The only way I'm going to find out what the problem is by getting inside the door. Behind here is the electric window winder. Now this consists of a mechanism, kind of like a scissor, which lifts the window up and down. And attached to that is a motor which drives that mechanism. Now hopefully the fault is with the motor because that's the cheapest thing to fix. A useful tip is to tape the window into position to stop it falling into the door, and also makes it a lot easier to put back together again. I'm now ready to take the window winder out of the door, but this is a really important safety point. There's lots of metal in here, a scissor mechanism, so just be really careful with your fingers and just take your time. Voila. This is a brand new motor. I'm now going to connect it to the wiring limb of the car. If that works, then we know the old motor was faulty. That's a result. I reckon if we put that into the regulator, we'll have working windows.
A new window winding motor costs around £60. A new regulator costs significantly more, but some companies do rebuild them, and you can buy a refurbished second-hand one for around £40.
Fantastic, the regulator works, which means the motor was at fault. I can now put this back in the door. Before I put the door card on, it's worth checking to make sure the window goes down, which it does, and up. Hurrah! All the way, both ways. I can now put everything back together again and get on with the other side.
A quick troubleshoot of the driver's side electric window showed that the motor here was at fault too. So once again, it's a case of carefully stripping the door and replacing the dead part. This is a fiddly and time-consuming job, but it makes such a difference to the experience of driving the car that it's really worth the effort.
Well, that's the electric windows fixed, so at least now it won't be like driving around in a Swedish sauna.
Click here to subscribe.